start the Young Investigator Award. Thank you. My name is Flemming Dehler from University of Copenhagen, and I have the pleasure of chairing this together with Professor Jan Capri, sitting over there from Luxembourg Institute of Sports Medicine. I'm chairing the ECSS Scientific Board and Committee, and we have had a long process in selecting those four we're about to hear. A little bit on how everything came to this point. First of all, we received a lot of abstracts, 368. Out of those, we evaluated 212. The reason why some did not make it to the 212 was mainly because people don't remember how old they are. And they do not pay their registration fee, or they did not remember how long time it was since they obtained a PhD degree, and other administrative issues. So we went down to 212. Those 212 were all evaluated based on the abstract that was submitted by the author, and it was scored by expert members of the scientific board and committee. We score them with a score between 1 and 5. You can see the details there. And that left us with 8 oral presentations and 30 conventional printed poster presentations. Those we've seen during the Wednesday and Thursday. All presentations were evaluated, questions were asked and answered, and this was the second round of the presentation. Within the disciplines that we have in the college, social sciences and humanities, biomechanical and neuromuscular, the physiology and medicine, and the multi-interdisciplinary category. After having seen all those 80 and 30 presentations, we met again and identified the 4 presenters we're about to see here, plus the 6 equal fifths. And for the posters, we identified 4 persons with the first, second, third, and the 4th prize. So now we're going to hear the 4 presenters. They will present in alphabetic order, and they'll present in the same format as they did previously, 10 minutes, and thereafter 5 minutes of questioning done by a member of the scientific board and committee. When we heard all of them, we will return to our chambers, as you might say, vote, discuss, not too long, because within half an hour we will return with our result. So the decision will not be easy. All 4 of them have received very high scores in their first presentations, and they are all very good representatives of their field of research. Eventually, when we're finished with this, when we come back, we will be able to present these 4 prizes, and we look forward to that. We have some reviewing criteria. They are all available on the ECSS website. Of the most important ones, the work should be original, it should have relevance for sports and exercise, and it should ideally have potential future impact. All 4 of these live up to all criteria stated here and as on the website. If there were conflicts of interest among the members of the scientific board of interest, they abstained from participation in the evaluation and scoring. If they were co-authors, belonged to the same research group, same department, or had a personal relationship with any of the presenters. The all finalists we have here, listed here in alphabetic order, and the way the order they will present, as shown here, we'll start with Nima Gharahdaghi from University of Nottingham, who will talk about the physiological and mechanistic effects of chemically endogenous testosterone depletion during resistance exercise training in younger men, a double-blind, placebo-controlled clinical trial. And we would look very much forward to hear all of them, and I will ask the first presenter to enter the stage. Good luck.
Thank you, everybody. My name is Nima Gharahdaghi from University of Nottingham. I'm going to talk about my study titled The Physiological and Mechanistic Effects of Testosterone Depletion During Resistance Exercise Training in Young Men. Testosterone, as an anabolic steroid hormone, is secreted from lytic cells in testicles in men and from ovaries in females. This hormone is really important regulator of body composition and is associated with increase in fat mass, increase in muscle strength, and decrease in fat mass. These anabolic effects have made people to use this hormone as a therapy or doping during resistance exercise training to enhance the anabolic effects of resistance exercise training. For example, here, as you can see, the testosterone was given adjuvant to resistance exercise training, and it just enhanced the muscle mass in young men significantly compared to placebo group, which is suggesting that testosterone therapy is a key regulator of muscle hypertrophy during resistance exercise training. Taking testosterone therapy anabolic effects aside, after each resistance exercise, the level of endogenous testosterone increased as well. And this increase was associated with some anabolic effects, but the data about in these effects is quite contentious. For example, here, there is a really elegant study here. Then it showed that this study had two groups. Both groups had resistance exercise training as biceps curl for 15 weeks. But one group had lower body exercise just immediately before each training session starts to enhance the endogenous testosterone. And this pattern followed for 15 weeks, and as you can see, there is no any significant positive effect of increasing endogenous testosterone. However, we already showed that in our lab by Brooke et al. That endogenous testosterone improvement after each training session in men was determining an increase in muscle hypertrophy in young men compared to older men. But still, as I said, the result about the anabolic effects of endogenous testosterone and mechanism of that is contentious. And that was the reason we just designed this study to investigate the effects of endogenous testosterone depletion during resistance exercise training. Basically, we designed this study and recruited 16 men divided into two groups, placebo and Zoladex. Placebo group had just normal saline injection, abdominal subcutaneous injection, and Zoladex had gonadotropin-releasing hormone injection to decrease the testosterone. All participants had whole body resistant exercise training 3 times per week with 80% 1RM, and all participants had D2O as a tracer, which helped us to measure the muscle protein synthesis and estimated muscle protein breakdown. Furthermore, all participants had DEXA scanning and ultrasound imaging to help us to measure the body composition and muscle architecture. In addition, muscle biopsy was performed during first day of study in rare situation, immediately after first training session and after last training session to help us to measure the gene expression and signaling protein and muscle protein synthesis. Finally, OGTT, oral glucose tolerance test, was the final test we had in this study to measure the insulin sensitivity and glycemic control. Before I go through the main result of this study, I prefer quickly just talk about what exactly happened in Zoladex group. As you can see, after injection, because it affects the neuroendocrine connection, this injection just disconnects this neuroendocrine connection. It decreases the level of testosterone during first week of resistant exercise training, and the level of testosterone just enter in this gray area, which is representing the hypogonadism. And in line with that, because the testosterone performed into the muscle by connecting to androgen receptor, we showed that in line with decreasing testosterone, the androgen receptor gene expression increased in placebo but was blunted in Zoladex group. We already showed that the increase in gene expression of androgen receptor was in line with muscle hypertrophy. And now I'm going to talk about the main result of this study. We showed that increase in fat-free mass in placebo group was significant, while the response of Zoladex group was blunted. Total fat percentage decreased in placebo, but in the Zoladex group, there was an attenuated response. In line with the fat-free mass, muscle thickness increased in placebo, but didn't change that much in Zoladex group. Further about the muscle adaptation, we showed that the total strength percentage increased in placebo group, but was blunted in Zoladex group. And this increase was strongly correlated with increase in total testosterone. And now we showed that there was a blunted adaptation, muscle hypertrophy in the group with lower testosterone group. And now I'm going to talk about the physiological mechanism behind this blunted adaptation. The main mechanism is muscle hypertrophy. We showed that muscle protein synthesis increased in placebo group, but blunted in Zoladex. And in addition to that, muscle protein breakdown increased in placebo group, but again, not that much increase in Zoladex group. Taking these together, and because the muscle protein synthesis overcome the muscle protein breakdown, the protein turnover increased significantly in placebo, and finally fractional growth rate, the percentage per day, which derived from muscle mass data, increased significantly in placebo group, but not in Zoladex group. I'm going to step forward and talk about the mechanism again behind the protein accretion blunted in the Zoladex group. About translational efficiency, these two proteins, AKT and mTOR, are in hypertrophy pathway. We showed that the activation of these two proteins immediately, acutely after each exercise training increased in placebo group but blunted in Zoladex group. More about mechanism, translational capacity, which related to RNA content and its main marker of ribosomal biogenesis, increased in placebo, but didn't change that much in Zoladex group. And two genes related to anabolism, IGF-1EC, both increased significantly and followed the same pattern in placebo group but not in Zoladex. And again, same pattern in myogenesis gene expression, myogenin and Mi5 both increased but blunted in increasing placebo but blunted in Zoladex group. More about adaptation of muscle mass. We showed that after last OGTT, during last OGTT, the level of glucose didn't change between two groups, but level of insulin decreased in placebo in line with higher muscle mass, which was in line with muscle mass, and it shown that the insulin sensitivity increased in placebo group significantly compared to Zoladex group based on the Sederholm index. Then finally, as a conclusion, we showed that the Zoladex injection decreased the level of testosterone, which led to androgen receptor gene expression blunted and myogenic regulatory factors blunted as well in line with RNA content. In addition, the activation of proteins in hypertrophic pathway attenuated, which led to decreased blunted protein synthesis, which led to having less muscle hypertrophy in Zoladex, but not placebo group. Finally, insulin sensitivity blunted in Zoladex as well. Then, as a just endpoint, we showed in this study, endogenous testosterone is the permissive role, has a permissive role during resistance exercise training regarding muscle hypertrophy. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And now the questions will be asked by Professor José Calpe from the University of Las Palmas, Gran Canaria, Spain. Please go ahead, 5 minutes, and you may finish your answer within if a question has been put forward, and even though it goes beyond 5 minutes, but not too much. Please, José, go ahead.
Thank you. So congratulations for the study, quite
Thank
complex
you.
And a rather nice mechanistic approach. So for my first question, I will ask you to put the first slide of your presentation, please. Okay. Okay, yeah, that one. So the second bar, testosterone, is not having a star. Is this because testosterone is not increasing muscle mass without exercise, or what do you think? If you give testosterone to a human, yeah, muscle mass will be increased, or you need to add exercise to increase muscle mass?
I'm sorry, I didn't get your question quite clearly. Would you please just rephrase?
Yes. So, sorry for my English, but I will try to pronounce better. So, if you give testosterone, if you administer testosterone to a human, to a male, will you expect an increase in muscle mass with testosterone, or this is not common? Do you need to add strength training on top of the testosterone to have a significant increase in muscle mass?
Yes, here. Lots of studies look at the just effects of testosterone per se to increase the muscle mass and related adaptation. Initially, it depends. We are talking about older men or young men. This study is about younger men, but in older men, if I want to talk about, it just blunted responses, and it doesn't affect that much in older men, even after 6 months or 8 months injection. But young men, the data is a bit more promising, and testosterone per se, in some cases, could increase the muscle mass without training, in some cases.
Okay, can you go to the next slide of your presentation, the next one, where you have the administration of Zoladex, that one. So if I look at this graph, I can see that testosterone is going up in the first assessment. So is this a mistake, or what do you think about this?
Yes, this is the mechanism of Zoladex. Zoladex is, or gazarolin, is a gonadotropin-releasing hormone agonist.
So perfect, thank you, thank you. So then if you continue to look at the graph, it's going down, and I can see that very low androgen levels are not reached until day 24, and they stay low until 42, and then they start to increase.
Yeah.
So I would argue that you only have really low levels of testosterone during a very short period of time, only 3 weeks. The rest of the time, you have a substantial amount of testosterone. And maybe that's why you don't have muscle hypertrophy.
Sorry, again, I think I missed what you mean. But I'm so sorry, I need to ask you, please rephrase.
Yeah, that, you know, the lowest level of testosterone, that's close to zero, is only reached during 3 weeks. During the rest of the time, you have substantial testosterone.
Okay, yes.
So, and your training is lasting only 6 weeks. Why did you choose such a short time? 6 weeks is not a lot to try to prove muscle hypertrophy. I would like a longer period. Will you see more easily muscle hypertrophy with 12 weeks or 16 weeks or 6 weeks? What is better?
I refer just to the other studies about the prostate cancer, because in prostate cancer, they just keep using that every 4 weeks. As you can see, the mechanism is just every 4 weeks, and after 4 weeks, the testosterone level comes back to normal. Yes, if we carry on, it could be expected to increase the muscle-related adaptation to resistant exercise training in Zoladex group, because level of testosterone comes back to normal level. But as in prostate cancer, because the just therapy carried on for long time, it's training.
Okay. Can you put the next slide where you have the regression lines? Next one. That one. So I can see that there is a linear relationship between low testosterone levels and strength gain. So it's doing something, the level of residual testosterone that you have.
Time's up, a short end.
Pardon?
Time's up.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. We'll proceed to the next presenter. Please enter the stage. Yves-Alain Kuhn from the University of Fribourg, Switzerland, with the title of his talk, Improved Postural Control in the Elderly After Long-Term Balance Training is Related to Intracortical Inhibition Modulation. Please go ahead when you're ready.
Thank you very much for the introduction and welcome to my presentation about long-term balance training and cortical adaptations. It's a pleasure to be here on this very tiny stage. So, in general, elderly subjects demonstrate a high fall incidence rate when compared to young adults, and this is mainly due to impaired postural control. And as you can see here, the annual fall risk is quite high when 65 years old and over. So we can say that fall present in the elderly a major risk to health, but also one of the leading causes of injuries and deaths in Western countries. Now, what are the reasons of these impaired balance in the elderly? Well, we know that aging induces degeneration of numerous musculoskeletal structure and nervous system, such as a decline in sensory structure, also a decline in peripheral nerve fibers, a loss in brain volume, and also a decline in number and size of muscle fibers. Now, it is important to notice that all these structural changes might affect the functionality of this different system, which in turn might have an impact on the behavior, such as balance, for example. So now, what are the age-related functional changes? Well, when looking at changes in the brain, aging induces greater and more widespread cortical activation in the brain of elderly subjects, for example, in the primary motor cortex, PFC, PMC, SMA, PUTM, and so on. And this leads to a state of so-called cortical overactivation. So to summarize, it seems that aging induces a shift from an automatic lower level toward a more cortically controlled processing of posture. Now, one of the reasons of this overactivation is that elderly subjects demonstrate a lower level of intracortical inhibition within the primary motor cortex. So now it is very important to notice that I will only focus on this aspect during my presentation. So far, however, it is not known whether targeted intervention can upregulate intracortical inhibition in the elderly. So in order to do so, we wanted to investigate whether long-term balance training of 6 months can induce adaptations in intracortical inhibition. And we also wanted to evaluate the association between cortical and behavioral adaptations and also assess the time course of this brain adaptation during and after training. So the participants were aged between 66 and 81 years old. So 18 of them followed 1 hour of balance training twice a week during 6 months, while 15 of them served as a control group. Now, it is also important to notice that during balance training, the difficulty levels were progressively increased over the 6 months, and a broad selection of balance devices were used in order to vary the exercises. Now, all the participants were measured at four time points, so a pretest after 2 months, 6 months, and one follow-up test 12 months after the pretest. And at all time points, we assessed their level of intracortical inhibition and, of course, their level regarding the balance performance. So in order to do so to measure the behavioral changes, so I mean the balance performance, we used a force plate to measure the displacements of the COP, so the center of pressure, of two trials of 30 seconds each. And to measure functional changes in the brain, so we applied TMS, transcranial magnetic stimulation over the primary motor cortex to evoke short interval intracortical inhibition, CKI, in the tibialis anterior muscle. And this was assessed while balancing on the instable device. Also, we chose the tibialis anterior muscle because it has been shown that changes in this specific muscle are more pronounced and are more age-related when compared to soleus muscle, for example, or gastrocnemius medialis. Now, how is intracortical inhibition measured? So when stimulating the representation of the leg muscle over the primary motor cortex, a response can be observed in the target muscle. And this response is called motor evoked potential, so MEP, and is mainly due to the excitatory neurons. Now, if you stimulate the same area with two pulses, one below and one above the motor threshold, you will observe a smaller response in the same muscle. And this is mainly due to the activation of inhibitory interneurons, GABA-A type. And the ratio between these two amplitudes reflects the amount of intracortical inhibition found in the primary motor cortex, and this is called CKI, so short intracortical inhibition. Now I will directly jump to the results. So regarding the balance performance, here on the abscissa you can see all the time points, so pretest after 2-6 months, and also the follow-up test. And on the ordinate, you can see the COP, so the total distance given in centimeter. So the ANOVA revealed a significant interaction effect when comparing the performance between group and across time. And the post-hoc comparison indicated that in the intervention group, the balance performance was significantly enhanced after 2 and 6 months of training in this group, as no difference was found in the control group. In addition, The intervention group displayed better performance after 2 6 months of training and still after 6 months of detraining. Also, you can see here no difference was found at baseline. Now, regarding the result for the intracortical inhibition, so the same here, the four time points are exactly the same, and on the ordinate you can see the level of intracortical inhibition given in percent. So again, the ANOVA revealed a significant interaction effect when comparing the amount of intracortical inhibition between groups and over time, as you can see here. And post-hoc comparison again displayed or revealed that inhibition was greater after 6 months of training in the intervention group, while no difference was found in the control group. Also, as you can see here, the intervention group displayed significantly more inhibition at all time points, and again, except at baseline. We also tested the corticospinal excitability, so no difference were found in single pulse MAPs between groups and across time. And also, we wanted to test the amount of muscle activity before TMS, in order to ensure that EMG had no influence on the level of intracortical inhibition, and again, no difference in background EMG before brain stimulation and between TMS pulse type groups and over time was found. Also, a potential connection between the balanced performance progression after 6 months and the amount of intracortical inhibition was tested. And the correlation test indicated a negative correlation. So it means that the participants with the biggest adaptations in the intracortical inhibition after 6 months also displayed the biggest adaptation in the performance, balance performance. So it seems that aging induces more activity in cortical structures with less inhibition in the primary motor cortex. And we showed that with 6 months balance training, the amount of intracortical inhibition can be enhanced. So it seems that balance training might help to counteract age-related decline in intracortical inhibition. For example, when comparing our group of senior with a group of young adult, as you can see here, so balancing on the same device, you can see that the senior display more than 20% less inhibition. However, when looking at the time course of this brain adaptation in the senior group, it seems that the aging effect of cortical disinhibition or cortical overactivation is reversed. So the difference is only of about 10%. So to conclude, it seems that balance training induces changes in intracortical inhibition after 6 months. So it's the aging effects are kind of counteracted. And increased levels of cortical inhibition seems to contribute, of course, among other factors, to an improved postural control, or vice versa. And finally, the effect of long-term balance training seems to decrease after 6 months of detraining, but still the intervention group displayed more inhibition and better performance than the control group. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much. And the questions will be asked by Professor Markus Gruber from University of Constance in Germany. 5 minutes, please go ahead.
Thank you very much for sharing your research with us. I will start with your method you used for SICKI. So the interstimulus interval you used was?
It was a 2.5 milliseconds.
2.5 milliseconds.
Yes.
What would happen, or what happens when you increase the interstimulus interval?
So if you increase the EZ, you can, you will be more in the area of the intracortical facilitation, I guess. I have also to say that the new gold standard is 2.1 milliseconds for the intracortical inhibition. However, a very nice paper has shown that with the intensities we used, so 70% for the conditioning pulse and 120% for the second pulse, there is no difference between 2.5 and 2.1 milliseconds.
Okay. What if you decrease your stimulation intensity for the conditioning stimulus down to 60%? What do you expect will happen?
I didn't test that, but I guess with too low intensity, you cannot activate the GABA-A interneurons, I would say. But I'm not 100% sure.
Okay, good. Why? The next question relates to your experimental design. So you measured during task execution. Why did you not measure during rest?
So it is important to notice that I only presented a small amount of data we collected, because we did a lot of other experiments with fMRI, MRI, and so on. But we measured actually also CK while standing on solid ground, so not during balancing. And it's very interesting because the senior displayed also changes in intracortical inhibition while standing on solid ground, and no difference in the COP was found. So I guess this can be also taken as a general effect of balance training on the cortical adaptations.
Okay, but I mean, standing is also kind of a balance task,
yes,
a very simple one. So let's go to task difficulty, which seems to be a major issue then. How would you define the difficulty of a balance task?
So again, I only presented the first level of difficulty. We had four levels of difficulty while balancing. It is also important to notice that we measured two groups, so senior and young participants. And yes, so for when the difficulty increases, the CK is reduced. However, with senior, it's very difficult because the level one was already too hard, I would say.
So if the difficulty is increased, so CK
is reduced. Yeah, we saw that with the young participants.
Okay.
For example.
When you train, what will happen to the task you train? Will it be more difficult or more easy?
So, of course, if you train this specific task, it's going to be easier for you.
Okay, what would then happen to CK?
I would say that the task is becoming easier, so it's more automatized in the cortex, and CK might be enhanced, I would say. So
okay.
It reflects this
Does this explain your results?
Yes, but as I explained before, we also had this effect in the senior group when standing on solid ground without any difference in the COP. So it might be interpreted that it wasn't easier to stand for senior. However, the inhibitory circuits were easier to activate, so it seems there is also a general effect which can be induced by a balance training, I would say.
Okay. How did you measure, or how did you determine motor threshold? Because during standing you have activation of the muscle?
Yes, so it was done in a very classical procedure, so we looked for 100 microvolt MEP amplitudes. Also, when standing on this first level, on the spin top, which was kind of easy, the activity is not changing a lot. So it was not that difficult to determine the motor threshold.
Time.
However, for higher levels, it was more difficult, and the post-processing regarding the data was more complicated to deal with.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. And we'll continue with the third. Kiara O'Brien, University of Birmingham, United Kingdom, with the title Health-Related and Psychosocial Correlates of Sedentary Behavior in People Living with Rheumatoid Arthritis, a Longitudinal Study. Please go ahead when you're ready.
Good afternoon, everyone. Today I'll be presenting a longitudinal investigation into the health-related and psychosocial correlates of sedentary behavior in people with rheumatoid arthritis. Rheumatoid arthritis is a chronic autoimmune disease characterized by high-grade inflammation. This contributes to articular and extra-articular disease manifestations, for example, functional disability and compromised psychological well-being. As many of you are aware, sedentary behavior has been defined as any waking behavior expending energy less than or equal to 1.5 metabolic equivalents while sitting, reclining, or lying. Physical inactivity is not participating in recommended levels of physical activity of moderate to vigorous intensity. It has been reported that sedentary behavior is adversely associated with health. For example, worsened physical function and worsened psychological well-being. Importantly, the negative health outcomes of sedentary behavior arise independently from participation in moderate to vigorous intensity physical activity. More recently, the potential of light intensity physical activity for improving health has been explored. Although in their infancy, studies have demonstrated beneficial links with systemic inflammation and psychological well-being. Although these health outcomes are very relevant for the rheumatoid arthritis population, a paucity of studies exist in the area, and those that do use a cross-sectional design and also self-report instruments. Indeed, only 9 rheumatoid arthritis studies use objective instruments to measure sedentary time and physical activity in this patient group. The actigraph accelerometer and active power posture sensor are 2 examples of objective instruments. The actigraph accelerometer has been used in rheumatoid arthritis studies. However, no rheumatoid arthritis specific accelerometer cut points have been developed for the measurement of sedentary time and physical activity in this population. Also, the active PAL is the gold standard measure of sedentary time, but no rheumatoid arthritis studies have employed the active PAL for this purpose. Aim 1 of this study was to investigate the longitudinal associations between objectively assessed sedentary time using the active PAL and the actigraph GT3X with pertinent health outcomes in people with rheumatoid arthritis, specifically rheumatoid arthritis disease activity, systemic inflammation, functional disability, depressive symptoms, and subjective vitality. Primarily, I conducted a validation study in order to, 1, develop novel rheumatoid arthritis-specific accelerometer cut points for the measurement of sedentary time and physical activity in this population, and 2, to assess the accuracy of the active PAL to measure sedentary time, standing, and stepping. Firstly, the actigraph GT3X accelerometer was calibrated against indirect calorimetry in order to develop rheumatoid arthritis-specific accelerometer cut points for the measurement of sedentary time and light intensity physical activity. Secondly, the active PAL was validated against direct observation. As you can see by the Blant-Altman plots, good agreement was shown with small mean differences and narrow limits of agreement. With this in mind, the novel rheumatoid arthritis-specific sedentary time accelerometer cut point could be explored further in terms of validity. Using the criterion of the active PAL, the rheumatoid arthritis-specific cut point showed smaller mean differences and narrower limits of agreement than widely used non-rheumatoid arthritis cut points. Therefore, the former was employed in the study. If associations are present between sedentary time, physical activity and health in this patient group, then modifiable determinants of these behaviours must be explored. Autonomous motivation, stemming from self-determination theory, might provide a modifiable target for intervention. No rheumatoid arthritis studies have explored determinants of these behaviours. Therefore, aim 2 of this study was to investigate the longitudinal associations between self-determined motivation for reducing sedentary time with objectively assessed sedentary time in people with rheumatoid arthritis, again using the active PAL and the actigraph GT3X. Methodology was as follows. Participants visited the hospital for data collection, whereby they undertook physical assessments. This has included the disease activity score 28, which is a widely used clinical tool to measure rheumatoid arthritis disease activity. Questionnaires were completed, including the Dartmouth Coop charts, the hospital anxiety and depression scale, the subjective vitality scale, and the behavioral regulation neck size questionnaire too. Participants were then fitted with the Actigraph GT3X accelerometer, an active power posture sensor, in order to measure their sedentary time and physical activity over 7 days. Time point one was repeated 6 months later in order to allow for sufficient variability in health outcomes and sedentary time in this population. For aim one, regression analysis was conducted in order to examine whether change in sedentary time and change in physical activity predicted change in health. For aim two, regression analysis was conducted to examine whether change in autonomous motivation to reduce sedentary time predicted change in sedentary time and change in physical activity. 53 participants took part in the longitudinal study. 72% of participants were female, which is representative of the rheumatoid arthritis population, and they had moderate disease activity. For aim one, change in active power assessed sedentary time positively predicted change in DAS28, CRP, functional disability and depressive symptoms, and negatively predicted change in subjective vitality. Reverse associations were found for standing, with less so for stepping. Only change in Actigraph GT3X assessed sedentary time positively predicted change in CRP. For aim two, change in autonomous motivation to reduce sedentary time negatively predicted change in active power and Actigraph GT3X assessed sedentary time, with reverse associations found for stepping, standing, and light intensity physical activity. This is the first longitudinal study to examine the associations between health-related and psychosocial correlates of sedentary time and physical activity in rheumatoid arthritis. This is also the first study to validate simultaneously the ActivPow and Actigraph GT3X accelerometer for the measurement of these behaviours in this patient group. ActivPow assessed behaviours were adversely associated with pertinent health outcomes in rheumatoid arthritis, for example, disease activity and inflammation. Only Actigraph GT3X assessed sedentary time was adversely associated with inflammation. This is the first study to explore the determinants of sedentary time and physical activity in rheumatoid arthritis. Self-determination theory might provide an important framework for behavior change interventions that target sedentariness in this patient group. Fostering lifestyles that increase physical activity and decrease sedentary time may be fundamental in improving the health of the rheumatoid arthritis population. However, more longitudinal studies need to be done with larger sample sizes, as well as experimental studies to confirm findings and infer causality. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you very much. And the questions will be asked by Professor Pierre Nicolas Lemieux, Norwegian School of Sports Sciences from Norway.
Good afternoon. Thank you for sharing your research and for your presentation. In your model, you're reporting a unidirectional relationship. Have you used statistical or theoretical arguments for testing your unidirectional model? And are there any additional models that would be possible to test?
Yes, so in most research with rheumatoid arthritis, looking at the health outcomes from, for example, physical activity, so it hasn't been done in sedentary behavior yet, they do tend to look at the health variables as outcomes. So we've sort of followed this lead in terms of linking these two things together. However, it is possible to assess bidirectional relationships between the health variables and the sedentary time and physical activity levels, and we are actually doing this. We first looked at them as outcomes and found this, and now we're swapping it around and running regressions with predictors. And then what we're going to do is use structural equational modelling in AMOS in order to look at these actually bidirectionally, because of course it is possible that these relationships are bidirectional, and it would make sense if they were.
There are research findings confirming that there is a positive effect of physical activity on quality of life in RA patients when they're able to be active. How do you identify when RA patients are able to exercise or increase their physical activity levels?
Sorry, so how am I able to identify if they are able to?
Yes.
Okay. So I would argue that anyone with rheumatoid arthritis could increase their physical activity levels. They generally do have low levels of physical activity, especially moderate to vigorous. However, the reason why we're looking at light intensity physical activity is because this might be more feasible for them. So, for example, potentially breaking up their sedentary time or reducing their sedentary time and replacing it with light intensity physical activity. So I guess linking then again with the autonomous motivation, how autonomously motivated they are, this might indicate how likely they are to do so. Does that answer your question?
Okay, thank you. In this study, as well as in studies with other populations, it is suggested that active PAL device is superior to waist-worn GT3X accelerometer in measuring sedentary time and changes in posture. Your result confirmed this in a population of RA patients, but your additional findings that the GT3 device is accurate in assessing light PA suggest that both devices have merit for use in this population. However, wearing both devices is burdensome for your patients and is time and resource intensive for researchers, as you may have noticed yourself. So what device do you feel is the best to use in this population and why?
Okay, in my personal opinion, the active PAL should be used for sedentary time measurement. So although we have validated the GT3X in this population, we are still finding that it's overestimating sedentary time by about 2 hours. And we think this is because it's incorporating standing, which is obviously the posture element. It's a low energy behavior, but the posture is standing, so it's not sedentary behavior. So I would say use the active PAL for sedentary time measurement and the Actigraph GT3X for physical activity measurement. If both aren't possible, I would personally use the active PAL, mainly because if you're looking at sedentary time, that is the gold standard, and we've validated it against direct observation in this population, as it has been validated in other populations, such as older adults. So that would be my personal opinion. But if not possible, then do use the GT3X, but just be cautious of the sedentary time estimations that it's giving out.
All right. You applied only one of several constructs of SDT, namely autonomous motivation. What was your rationale for making this decision, and what impact does this have on the application of self-determination theory in designing future intervention for this population?
So our reasoning behind using autonomous motivation is because it has been used in intervention development with this population in terms of increasing and promoting physical activity. So we thought we'd use it as a starting point for our study, as it's very observational. So if we did find links between autonomous motivation and sedentary time in this population, then later on we can look sort of at their basic psychological needs of competence, autonomy, and relatedness.
Time. That's so, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, and we will turn to the last speaker, Natalie Shure, University of Nottingham, United Kingdom, with the title, 3 days, bed rest applicability impairs whole body glucose disposal, which is fully restored by exercise, but is not further accentuated after 50 days. Bed rest. Please go ahead when you're ready.
So thank you very much, first of all, for this absolutely fantastic opportunity to present. I'm a doctor in sport and exercise medicine and a PhD student from the University of Nottingham, and today I'm going to be presenting to you some of my data collected during my PhD. So we know from previous bed rest experiments that immobilization leads to a reduction of insulin-mediated both whole body and muscle glucose disposal. However, previous bed rests have only tended to focus on pre and post time points, such that there still remains a lack of insight as to what the rate and magnitude is of change. Now, this is important if we are potentially to maximize the timing of some of the countermeasures to prevent this. Furthermore, shorter acute periods of immobilization may be much more relevant to clinical populations who may undergo periods of incapacitation of only a few days due to illness or injury. Finally, previous bed rest experiments haven't always accounted for dietary energy intake, and this is very important because it's still unclear whether some of the endpoints measured are secondary to overfeeding or inactivity per se. Therefore, the main aims of this study was to determine the rate of change of both insulin-mediated whole body glucose disposal and substrate oxidation using an acute bed rest model over a chronic bed rest model, whilst maintaining energy balance in our participants. Our secondary aim was to determine whether a short period of reambulation and resistance exercise could restore some of these changes in glucose disposal following acute bed rest. So moving on to my methods, I'm going to talk you through the chronic bed rest model to begin with. 20 healthy male physically active participants were recruited to undergo 60 days of -6 head down tilt, and this happened in the MEDES facility in Toulouse in France in collaboration with the European Space Agency. Now the reason for the -6 head down tilt is because you get the fluid shifts towards the head that mimic what happens in microgravity. Prior to the period of bed rest, these participants underwent a two-week period of run-in phase within the unit, and this was to standardize their energy intake and also their exercise levels. Our team undertook measures at two different time points indicated by the blue arrows, and that was day -6 during the run-in and day 56 during the bed rest. The measures we undertook were the hyperinsulinemic euglycemic clamp to measure whole body glucose disposal and indirect calorimetry to measure substrate oxidation. In addition to the chronic bed rest model, we performed an acute bed rest experiment at the University of Nottingham with the same experimental design as in Toulouse. And here we recruited 10 healthy, physically active males. However, they had time points, measures taken at three time points indicated by the red arrows. And those were day -4 during the run-in, again, which was standardized after 3 days of head down tilt. However, in addition, after the bed rest, they were free living, but they had a daily resistance exercise program of maximal isokinetic knee extensions, and that happened on day 4, 5, and 6. And finally, the measures were repeated on day 7. Now, in both bed rest experiments, participants had a standardized diet with a fixed macronutrient content, which you can see on the slide. In addition to this, their energy intake was reduced during the period of bed rest to reflect their reduction in energy expenditure. And finally, the chronic bed rest participants had a weekly serial DEXA scan to account for any small changes in body weight or body composition so that small adjustments in their diet could take place. This slide represents our experimental protocol. So we utilized the hyperinsulinemic euglycemic clamp, which is a technique to measure peripheral insulin sensitivity. And we do this by giving a primed continuous infusion of insulin. In this case, the rate was 60 milliunits per meter squared per minute. And then we give a continuous variable glucose infusion to maintain euglycemia. In this case, it was 4.5 millimoles per liter. And this went on for 3 hours. Prior to this, participants had a muscle biopsy with a Bergstrom needle performed prior and in the final 15 minutes of the insulin clamp. And they also had indirect calorimetry data collected prior to and in the final 30 minutes of the insulin clamp. This very simple table just briefly describes the basic participant demographics, and it's really to draw your attention to the fact that they were matched by BMI. So I'm going to move straight on to the main findings of our study. If you'd like to focus on the graph on the left to begin with, so here I've plotted our insulin clamp data with time in minutes across the x-axis and whole body glucose disposal, which we've standardized to lean body mass using DEXA scores, which is in micromoles per kilogram per minute. And we used the steady state values, which in this case were 135, 150, and 165 minutes. We don't take the final endpoint. So one of the most important findings from our study was that in healthy males, after only 3 days, we get a significant decline in whole body glucose disposal of a magnitude of 30%. Now, to reflect back to our secondary aim, could this be restored by a short period of reambulation and resistance exercise? You can see from the gray line that it was fully restored. Then if you contrast this to our chronic bed rest experiment, which we've plotted on the right hand of the slide, again with the exact same axes, despite the fact that these were different participants, we still see a similar magnitude of decline in whole body glucose disposal. Next, moving on to substrate oxidation. So just briefly, when we are fasted, the body tends to predominantly use fat as a fuel to spare glucose for the brain. However, once we eat a meal or an insulin-stimulated state, the body predominantly uses carbohydrate as a fuel. So here I've plotted carbohydrate oxidation, if you focus on the graph on the left, with pre and post bed rest on the x-axis, and carbohydrate oxidation, which we've standardized to lean body mass in milligrams per kilogram per minute. And the gray bars represent in the insulin-stimulated state. The first thing that you can see from both these graphs is that at all time points, in both acute and chronic bed rest, we see a robust stimulation of carbohydrate oxidation in response to insulin. However, in acute bed rest, whilst we see no significant differences in the response to insulin in with carbohydrate oxidation, in chronic bed rest, we see a reduced stimulation of carbohydrate oxidation after 56 days. Similarly, looking at fat oxidation, again with pre and post bed rest on the x-axis, and fat oxidation, which we standardized to lean body mass on the y-axis, again, what you can see at all time points in both acute and chronic bed rest is we see a suppression of fat oxidation in response to insulin. However, in acute bed rest, we see no statistically significant differences in the response to insulin. In chronic bed rest, we see a reduced suppression of fat oxidation. Now, the changes I've just demonstrated here are changes at a whole body level. So the next thing we asked ourselves is, can we see anything at a muscle level that might parallel or corroborate these findings? And here I've presented some muscle glycogen data from the muscle biopsies. And here, again, pre and post bed rest on the x-axis, and muscle glycogen, which is in millimoles per kilogram dry mass, on the y-axis. And here, if you just focus on the pre-bed rest time point in both cases, you can see in the presence of insulin at baseline that there's an increase in muscle glycogen. Again, this makes sense. Insulin stimulates glucose to be stored. However, in both acute and chronic bed rest, we see no significant change in muscle glycogen in response to insulin. And this indicates that there's a reduction in the non-oxidative glucose disposal. And these findings do indeed parallel our findings of a reduction of whole body glucose disposal in acute and chronic bed rest. So I'd like to summarize what I've said. Firstly, acute bed rest leads to a substantial decline in whole body glucose disposal of a magnitude of 30% whilst participants are in energy balance. And this isn't further worsened after 56 days in bed. And we find that this is paralleled by a decrease in non-oxidative glucose disposal, which is demonstrated by a reduction in muscle glycogen storage in response to insulin. However, looking at substrate oxidation, whilst in acute bed rest, we see no significant changes in the response to insulin, in chronic bed rest, we see a reduction of carbohydrate oxidation and a reduced suppression of fat oxidation. The third point is that a short period of reambulation and resistance exercise does indeed fully restore whole body glucose disposal. Ongoing work in our team are to elucidate some of the potential mechanisms that might be driving these important changes. But the take-home message that I want you to get from this particular talk is that a short period of bed rest of only 3 days leads to a substantial decline in whole body glucose disposal, which is not further accentuated after 56 days. So So as you can imagine, these are quite difficult studies to pull off, and it is a huge team effort. So I have a huge deal of thanks to everyone listed on this slide. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And the questions will be asked by Professor Wim de Raaf, University of Ghent in Belgium. Go ahead.
Thank you very much. I think these are really great studies, and you did a fantastic job in presenting it. But please help me with some clarifications. One is about the glucose disposal. Can you flick that back, the glucose disposal? So the unit or the amount you dispose is about 10 micromolars per kilogram muscle per minute. How much of that will be oxidized?
So you can actually do a calculation for that. So from our muscle glycogen data and our whole body glucose disposal, you can actually calculate that. I have to admit, I don't know that off the top of my head.
If you say 10 micromolars per kilogram is going in the muscle,
yeah.
And then your next slide is showing how much is oxidized.
Yes.
And that is 4. Would that mean that about 40% of the glucose that goes into the muscle is oxidized?
That's a good point. I mean, in insulin-stimulated situation, the muscle is the main organ, if you'd like, responsible for...
About 80%, so yeah. Yes. So maybe we could do that?
I'm not sure what calculation we would do, sorry.
The problem is you are showing milligrams here, and in the previous slide you're showing micromolars. So
right.
That makes it very difficult.
Okay.
If you convert it to micromolars, your glucose oxidation is 200% of your glucose disposal. That's of course not possible. So maybe one or the other is under or overestimated, I think.
Okay, so it's an issue with our units. So I probably need to go away and
do some calculations.
It's not in
the same units yet. The second part, the part that is not oxidized is converted to glycogen.
Yes,
right?
Or lactate.
If you have 10 micromolars per kilogram per minute, if you multiply that by 180 minutes, you would end up with about 1 to 2 millimolars per kilogram. And your increase in glycogen is how much? 200. So again, I think there's a disparity between the calculated non-oxidative glucose disposal and then your glycogen. But I was really surprised to see such a high accretion of glycogen at such
okay.
a short time.
Thank you for okay. pointing that out.
Okay. If you go to the very first slide, I'm glad you cite our chair of the scientific committee. That's a great study. It's the first one showing it. How does your insulin concentration relate to this study? And what were the concentrations of insulin you found in your hyperinsulinemic clamp?
Yes, so the Mikinez paper in 91, they had a three-step clamp. So low level, intermediate level, high level, and their intermediate level was 40 compared to our 60. So
you had 60?
Yes.
Micro units?
So in terms of the insulin levels, in our particular study,
the infusion, but what did you get in the in the blood?
So it was approximately 100 to maybe 150 micro units per liter.
Okay. Would it, you had to take one concentration or one step only.
Yeah.
Would the conclusion have been different if you had a higher concentration or lower concentration? Or did Mikinez and Galbo find the same results with all the concentrations?
So we particularly chose 60 milliunits because it's been shown in previous studies to suppress hepatic glucose production in both insulin-sensitive and insulin-resistant states, and that's really important because the insulin clamp only works if you reach a steady state. So if you haven't fully suppressed hepatic glucose production, then you can't say that the glucose infusion equals the glucose uptake. So, and in fact, Mikinez did measure hepatic glucose production using tracers, and they found that it was completely suppressed. So I'm quite pleased in our study that I think we did suppress hepatic glucose production. Mikinez found, in particular, because they looked at leg glucose uptake, that this was significantly decreased after a period of immobilization. And that's important because that implies that the leg or the muscle in particular is the focus for the mechanisms that underlie the whole body changes. Obviously, liver and other tissues do contribute a small amount, but mostly the leg.
Thank you. Your oxidation rates of glucose and fat are based on indirect calorimetry. Did you ignore protein oxidation, potential protein oxidation?
So
time saved by time.
Should I finish that? We didn't
thank
measure
you.
Urinary nitrogen, but
thank
we used
you.
The non-protein. Okay, thank you.
Okay.
So, I almost said this is the end, at least of the four presentations, but now you will continue with the rest of the program for the closing ceremony. It's supposed to take place in 5 minutes, and the scientific board and committee will return to chambers. We'll be back. Sorry for the waiting time here. We were preparing the slides. We are ready now. And we can proceed slowly in the right order. We will start with acknowledgement, the hard work from all the members here, except me, from the scientific committee and the scientific board who have been evaluating everything, and the ECSS is really grateful for that work. First of all, I have the pleasure of announcing the YIA Travel Grant winners for this year, and we had four of them that got this prize, and we congratulated them with this, and it's sponsored by the two you can see on the slide. Then we will proceed to the YIA winners. They were celebrated Thursday evening, and for the oral fifth, we had Megan Bentley from Leeds Beckett University in United Kingdom, Matthias Koenig from London South Bank University, Robert Morton from McMaster University, Sarah Ukiyawa from McMaster, Trey Titmarsh from University of Birmingham, and Emilia Verkhausen from Norwegian School of Sport Sciences. In the fourth place was Cass Fuchs, Maastricht University Medical Center. The third was Tesai Kono, Tokyo University, and the second was Charlotte Richter. This leaves only one for the first prize we would like to see here on stage. And this is Michael Wheeler, University of Western Australia. Please. Okay, keep standing. We will continue for the oral presentations. The ones we just saw, and we'll start from the back. The fourth is Nima Gharahdaghi, University of Nottingham. Please give him a hand. Third is Natalie Schur, University of Nottingham, United Kingdom. Congratulations. The second is Tiara O'Brien, University of Birmingham. So, it's of no surprise that the winner is Yves-Alain Kuhn from the University of Fribourg, Switzerland. So, thanks to all the participants. You did good.
you are already winners, as I said yesterday, even before you gave your second presentation. It was fantastic, all of them. They were good. It was a hard choice, actually. I won't reveal the details, but it was a hard choice, and you were all very good representatives of your research area. So please join me giving them a hand, and I don't know if Thomas, he usually wants a lot of pictures. Yes. Okay. So this concludes my task here, and I will leave the stage to our president.
And please could we give a round of applause to our chair of the scientific board, Professor Fleming Della, for all the hard work he does. At this point, I'd also like to acknowledge some very hardworking colleagues for the college, and that's our executive board. Especially this week, because we had a lot on, you didn't see us too often, but trust us, we were working very hard for the college. And at this juncture, we're in a transition, and two of our very valued members of the board will be rotating off. So if I can please call Professor Stephen Seiler to the stage. Now, Stephen has been with us on the board for 6 years. Actually, we joined it together, so we went through the rookie year at the same time, learning the situation. He was responsible for enhancing our media presence and publications. I think there's no question that all your hard work really has enhanced the applied sports science component of this college, and that's a very important component, and under your leadership, the SIG related to elite sport performance has just flourished. So we very much thank you for that. I think if going back over the years and all our meetings, you've definitely brought a fresh perspective. You asked challenging questions. You made us think out of the box, which is very good and very healthy for a college. And I personally will thank you for your, as the British would say, cheeky sense of humor and always being there with a quick laugh at those moments in those long meetings when we needed it. So, Stephen, we will miss you. Thank you for your contributions. Okay, and if I also now can call up, with pleasure, Professor Tim Cable. Hi, Tim. Yeah. Well, following the very successful 2011 Congress in Liverpool, Tim became an integral part of our executive board, and he was a great predecessor to my presidency, and making it much easier in terms of coming in and taking the reins. I think during your time with us, there's no question that you spearheaded a real step change in our development, becoming much more professional as a college. You helped us articulate a very inspiring and forward-thinking vision, and also important missions that we try to aspire to. And as well, because accountability and measurement is important in science, is important also in executive committees and colleges, identified key performance indicators to keep us on track to make sure we were progressing. Tim was also very instrumental in securing and helping us continue with at least two really important sponsors for this college, our platinum sponsor as well as our gold sponsor, GSSI and Catapult. And two, on a personal note, when you joined the board and we have a lot of important issues to discuss, I think what is important as well is that you have an environment that is comfortable, that is challenging, and that people feel free to express their opinions. We don't want to always agree, but we want to come to consensus, and you definitely facilitated that. So we're going to be very sad to see you leave the board. We know you're not leaving the college. It'll always be part of your life. Thank you very much for your contributions. Thank you. For me, it very much has been an honor to serve as your president over the last 2 years. Some moments it seemed like it was going a little slow, but when I think back, it actually has flown by. We're going to have some changes in the board. Let me announce two new members of the executive board who will be joining us, like officially tomorrow, and that is Professor Janice Thompson, University of Birmingham, United Kingdom, who was elected on the board. And Professor Alexander Ferrucci from Ruhr University of Bochum, Germany. So in terms of honors, it's an honor now for me to introduce our incoming president, who I have no question is also going to have this college keep moving forward. And I'd like to welcome to the stage and the podium, please, Professor Mueller, Eric, from the University of Salzburg in Austria.
Thank you, John. John, I would like to thank you on behalf of the ECSS office, the executive board, the scientific board, and the committee for the huge amount of work you have invested into ECSS the last few years. Due to your very, very high leadership competences, you brought ECSS forward to the right direction in a very fast speed. You were mainly responsible for the last two very successful congresses in Dublin and here in Prague. And without you, it wouldn't have been possible to be where we are now. Joan, you can really be proud of what you have invested into sports science in Europe during your professional career, but also very much during your presidency of the ECSS College. And let me give you a personal remark. I would like to thank you very much for your personal friendship. Thanks a lot and all the best for your future. Best quality wine will make it possible for her to taste it in very small portions and to be proud each time she has one of these tastes on what she has done. Dear colleagues, I feel very honored to be allowed to take over the presidency of the European College of Sports Science for the upcoming 2 years. Together with my colleagues in the office, the executive board and the scientific board and committee. We will work very hard, and I can promise we will really do so, to make sure that the missions we had given us a couple of years ago will be fulfilled the next few years. The two most important missions are to disseminate high-quality research on a multidisciplinary level and its application during our annual congresses. We have to make sure that the quality of the scientific program will be the highest possible. And we also make to have sure that the journal we own and we have reached a quality on, which is extremely high already, will be increased in the quality, which means we will focus on the increase of the impact factor and hope that due to this, it will be even more attractive for our members of the college to publish their research work in our journal. And in addition to this, I think maybe even the most important mission we have is to empower the development of the young scientists in sports science all over the world with a focus on the members of our college. We will be able to provide platforms for them, mainly with respect to the Young Investigator Award you have seen this afternoon. But also we will provide possibilities to them to do networking, to do a lot of social activities, because I'm very, very much convinced that the future in sports science in general, but especially for the young generation, will be multidisciplinary, will be international networking and multi-center research projects. This is the future of ECSS in general, but especially for the young scientists, and we will be very much enthusiastic to work on this the upcoming 2 years. I'm very much looking forward to work with all of you again. Thank you.
And now it's a great pleasure to indicate that the 2019 ECSS Congress in Prague is officially closed. And also announce that we'll see you all at the Zenin Palace at 8 o'clock, because it's party time. Thank you very much.